my life I has to fight. All's my life I hard times like yeah, bad trips like yeah. Nazareth, I'm fucked up, homie, you fucked up. But if God got us, then we gon' be alright.
We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Huh? We gon' be alright. We gon' be alright. Do you hear me? Do you feel me? We gon' be alright.
And when I wake up, I recognize you looking at me for the pay cut. Bahamas, I be looking at you from the face down. One Mac 11, even boom with the face down. Scheming, now let me tell you about my life. Painkillers only put me in the twilight. We're pretty Benjamin is the highlight. I tell my mama I love her, but this what I like. Lord knows, 20 of them in my Chevy. Tell them all to come and get me, reaping everything I sow. So my karma come in heaven, no preliminary hearings on my record. I'm a gangsta in silence for the record. Tell the world I know it's too late. Boys and girls, I think I've gone crazy. Trying to side my vices all day. Won't you please believe when I say, when you know we've been hurt, been down before. When our pride was low, looking at the world.
You know, up to life imprisonment, so on and so forth. And also breaks homes. It breaks up families. It breaks up homes. They leave children with no parents in the home. And I'm just going to say no fathers in the home. Mm-hmm. Because the fastest growing population of incarcerated people are females. You know, females population in the prison system is increasing in record numbers. So it's not just a male thing anymore. You know, it's a people thing. So with that being said, you know, it's a very high number of young children that are fatherless or motherless out there in society due to incarceration. So incarceration affects people of all walks of life. And it's not just a color thing. It's a color thing only in respect that, like for example, in the state of New Jersey, you have a population of about maybe somewhere between 15 to 18,000 people incarcerated. They have about maybe, I think about 10 or 11 prisons or something in that area. And 73% of the population is African American. But we only make up about 13% of the population in the state. So how do those numbers work? You know, how you have a 73% African Americans incarcerated in New Jersey, but we only make up a small percentage of the entire population in the state. Something's very wrong with that picture. These are the type of statistics and the numbers that we need to change. We need to change that narrative, and it has to start with us. We have to take a grassroots approach, you know, hands on boots on the ground approach to trying to stem back this epidemic, you know, and this roller coaster that a lot of our young men and women are riding on, you know. So we're going to elaborate a little bit about that. We got some special guests in the studio. I'm going to let each individual introduce themselves and talk a little bit about what it is that they do, and, you know, what it is that they would like, whatever information they would like to impart to the people that's listening and our audience out there. So I'll start with the brother right across from me. You could just introduce yourself, brother. Tell us a little bit about you, where you're from, and what it is that you do.
Good day. My name is Shanduke McPhatter, also better known as Tripe Gangster. I'm born and raised in Brooklyn, New York. Formerly incarcerated between the ages of 16 and 30. I did 13 years of total installment time between Rikers Island and two state correctional facility bids. 2008, I was released from prison, and at that point I had decided to change my life, and I realized from all my incarceration that there was a lack of services and programming to deal with my issues, which was violence. So I needed to come up with something to help my community, so I formed my own 501c3 nonprofit organization known as G-MACC Incorporated, which stands for Gangsters Making Astronomical Community Changes Incorporated, and we're an organization that focuses on preventing shootings in our communities, mediating conflict, de-escalating violence, changing norms of our community by focusing on those most high risk to shoot or be shot, and provide the right type of resources to change the way they're living and the choices that they're making.
Wow, that's some very strong stuff there, brother. And so you out of where? Brooklyn, New York?
Born and raised.
Okay, so you know, and being from Jersey and Brooklyn, I think that a lot of the issues that we're dealing with in all of our the communities, whether it's in Brooklyn, whether it's in Newark, New Jersey, Paterson, New Jersey, Jersey City. I think we find this epidemic going on across the board, even out there in California on the West Coast. In light of the recent situation that just happened with us losing the great king Nipsey Hussle to gun violence, which plays right into, you know, what we're talking about in the topic and so on and so forth. So in your interaction, so naturally you said you was in the system, you was incarcerated for a period of time, you had some interaction on the streets and the criminal lifestyle or whatever the case may be, but then you overcame that, you removed yourself from that, and now you're giving back. You're speaking to the young brothers, you're trying to give them information and pull them up to keep them staying on the right track. Now in doing that, do you find that these brothers are being receptive to you and to the information, and they're willing to want to change, or do you find it a little difficult where a lot of the brothers are, you know, a little stubborn about, you know, removing themselves from that lifestyle?
Well, we all stubborn about a lot of different things, but for us, we don't focus on removing anybody from any type of lifestyle. We focus on the individual and what it is that they're going through and why they're making the decisions that they're making.
Right.
So often, the attention is paid on affiliations and how to take somebody out of that affiliation versus help the individual regardless of the affiliation. That's what we focus on. Because the majority of what you're talking about the predominant so-called gangs, which are unorganized organizations, they come from history of protecting the community. And so what we're really doing is going back to the basis, the grassroots of what these organizations, which are now unorganized and part of the major part of violence, going back to bringing reality to them. So many of our young brothers and sisters don't even know what they're representing, you know, what they're dying, what they're willing to die for, these flags that's being represented in front of them, and they have no history of recognition of that. So we don't really get a lot of pushback when you really talking about those who were in the 20s and 30s, and because they're still the catalyst, because those are the OGs, right?
Right.
And they're the ones who are the ones who have the ability to push the button or stop the button from being pushed. Well, our young brothers is trying to follow that trend, so we have to show them a different way. So when we're dealing with them, we don't get that push. You get your stuff individual, nobody can't tell me nothing, right? But you got to find a way to overcome that, because I've never been one that told me a child was going to overcome me or run my hood, right? That's the problem. Everybody can tell me, these young boys, you can't talk to them. And I'm not somebody, and nobody around me, we don't just accept that, because if that's not my child, that's your child, that's somebody in the community child. We need to have somebody accountable for that individual who feel like I don't give a fuck and I'm just letting off these shots.
Facts.
Definitely.
Wow, that's deep. Yeah. Yeah, now, you know, and just, you know, speaking from my perspective, you know, being, I work in the system, you know, so I'm on the front lines a lot of these guys that are on their way home from doing time and ready to make their reentry back into society, which is another aspect. See, you have different aspects of the criminal justice system, all right? You have the offender stage, where the person commits the crime, all right? Then you have the incarceration stage. Well, not before the incarceration stage.
You have the detained stage.
Right, you have the detained, right? Where they detain them, you're waiting to go to trial, or you obtain an attorney or public defender to try to defend yourself, so on and so forth. You go through the court process to determine if you're going to be found innocent and guilty or cop out, take a plea bargain.
Just say, right there, even, see, because the things learned in cities. In New York, we're fighting to change discovery laws in New York.
Right.
Because in New York, they use that, they hold all the information, they have all the information upon arrest, right, within the first days or weeks of arrest.
Right.
You'll be on Rikers Island for weeks, months, years,
right,
while they know everything, but they're trying to force you to plea out, to cop out, right? And then if you look at the evidence against you, the time they're offering you, it doesn't make sense. Right. So this is another tactic that we got to fight against as well.
So y'all trying to introduce like speedy trial like we got over here in New Jersey.
So we got 30-30 motion. You got speedy trial in New York, right? Mm-hmm. But a lot of people don't understand it, right? So if you don't have education on incarceration, and you get arrested, and you get a public pretender, is what we call them, right?
Right.
So you get that public pretender. Now, you don't know the difference between your time versus the court time when you're going to court. A lot of people don't know that. Meaning if I go to court and my attorney adjourns, that's time charged on me. Right? So that messes up my 30-30, and they don't know that. Right? So we are educating them on that. Because sometimes you're going to court and a public pretender is adjourning because they got so much more going on,
right,
and you're being held and you thinking that your rights are being violated, but it's your attorney doing such, right?
Pushing the
so, right, so we look at it from that. But when we talk about discovering New York, we have, like, somebody put in 30-30 and they'll find out, oh, well, your attorney did this. So you don't, now you got to sit there because now the DA has time to charge against your case. But what we're seeing is they can release you prior to, if they came after the grand jury and said, well, this is all of the evidence, right? This is what we have against you. With all of this now, you, it even changed the dynamics of your bail, right? Because they're telling you that they got all this evidence, so your bail is high, but when you see the evidence, it doesn't even substantiate the bail.
Right.
So this is what we're trying to change the information that the DA is able to hold and how long they're able to hold that discovery evidence.
Yeah, that's very important. And you know what? And you know, it's about education and brothers being aware of the law. See, you have a lot of these young brothers that aren't educated about the law, and the system preys on that, and they know that. So you got these young guys catching these serious cases, you know, double, triple shootings, you know, a murder, two murders, so on and so forth, attempted murders, and they're going into these counties and these jails, and a lot of them aren't abreast of the law and their rights and so on and so forth. And they, like you said, they get these public defenders, pretenders, whatever they call them. They have large caseloads. They can't really spend exorbitant amount of time dealing with that particular individual because they got so many guys they're representing. So they basically are coercing these guys into copping out to exorbitant amounts of time.
That's right.
You got some of these young dudes, say 19, 20, 21 years old, that are copping out to 20, 30-year sentences.
Right.
What kind of plea bargain is a 30-year sentence? You know, you probably get less than that if you go to trial and lose, you know?
My first prison sentence was in 96. Good?
Yeah.
My first prison sentence was 96.
Right.
And it was for a robbery and assault in the store. But I was sitting on the stoop when the crime happened, and they came and picked me out, and the dude from the store was an Arab, new to our country, said it was me, and I had nothing to do with it whatsoever. I ended up taking 3 years because my public defender said 3 years or turn me all the way away from everything. My violence went up, my whole mindset changed, and I went to do 3 years in state prison for something that, you know, right? So just think about how many more people are going through that.
Listen, I'm glad you said that. You know why? Because, listen, ordinary citizens are people that are unaware of the dynamics of the criminal justice system, and you'll be surprised of how many people that don't really know what goes on in the criminal process or the criminal justice process. A lot of people in society believe what they see on TV, what they see in movies, what they hear on the news, so on and so forth. And a lot of people can't fathom the idea of an individual being picked up and accused of a crime and actually copping out and or admitting to a crime that they did not commit.
Mm-hmm.
If you ask or you talk to people out in society, they'll tell you, oh, why would you agree to a crime that you didn't do? Why would you plead guilty? Why would you? But people don't understand that in the system with young black males being railroaded in the criminal justice system and the odds that are facing against you, it is a very realistic thing where you have some young guys that are completely 100% innocent, but in order to avoid a lengthy prison sentence, they will sit there and cop out to a crime they didn't commit just to get, you know, 18 months or 2 years.
Just to get out of there.
Just to get out of there. Right. Just to get some relief.
Just to know you got a date to go home.
Just know you got an opportunity to come home.
I was actually jammed up in a situation, a whole kidnapping, attempted murder charge and all this, right? Police took me through hella drama. Knew I ain't did it. In the courts, the prosecutor pulled me to the back. Right. Said, we know you ain't do it. We know it's this guy. We give you a year if you say you was with him to do that shit. You dumb as hell. Like, are you stupid?
I'll negotiate something down just so I can get out. And that's what you see a lot of in our system. Just get me out of this prison. I don't care if I do 4 years, 5 years.
Right.
I know that I don't want to even have to work to fight the courts to get out on some type of a bail pill or reversal. So they get the time. They know that. That's why they put us in there. That's why they snatch us up, because the system is going to stand behind that.
Right. You just want to see some light at the end of the tunnel. Now, that's just the first phase that we're talking about in the criminal element and so on and so forth. The first phase is, like I said, the criminality, committing the crime, being accused of a crime, going through the process, the judicial process of being found guilty or innocent, being incarcerated, receiving time, so on and so forth. And then you have the second phase, which is the incarceration, going to prison and doing time, all right? Being being incarcerated, we know, is a hardship on a lot of families. It's a hardship on a lot of individuals. A lot of incarcerated individuals don't have a support system. Having a support system while you're incarcerated is very important. A lot of guys don't have people, family members, so on and so forth, to hold them down while they're incarcerated. You know, so basically they're in there fending for themselves and, you know, trying to make the best that they can while incarcerated. And it also puts a financial strain on the families of incarcerated individuals, who a lot of families do support their loved ones and, you know, knock down the prison doors every visit, you know, bringing clothes and money, sending money orders and so on and so forth. So, you know, that's another element that's a burden on a lot of families, taking care of loved ones that's incarcerated, taking care of their children that they left out here. You know, you got a lot of grandparents raising kids because the parents are incarcerated. In some cases, both parents incarcerated. Yeah. Mother locked up and father locked up. You know, and the grandparents are stuck with raising these kids, which, you know, creates
that's
a burden.
Having on more kids. Right, actually, you got the grandkids up in there with the, you know, with the great-grandkids going with the kids in there sometimes.
Right. And you even, and in some, a lot of these facilities, you even have a dynamic where you have a lot of fathers incarcerated with their sons together in the same institution, yes, same facility.
That was actually what changed my life.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I was in Sing Sing, and I seen a father who was my mentor, his son, who we had on a conjugal visit. Kid was 17 years of age, and he had never met his father. And he ended up coming to prison with 35 years of life. Oh, and I was in there where he walked in the yard and met his father, just us three. So I saw that, and I was like, okay, that's not what I want for my children.
Right.
So that was when my mindset started to shift.
Right.
But that's just common. There's so many families that have family members together in the same facilities.
Absolutely.
Me and my older brother, that was what our life was. Both of us was in jail, but one of us was in the streets. Right. Right. So we have to look at that differently now and really talk about how that's affecting our families and in these homes. The grandparents that have to raise these young men. You know, mothers who try to be a single mother, it's not the same. You know, a father is going to bring something totally different to what your mother gave you. My mother gave mortgage papers and clothes, but the streets showed me something else. You know what I mean?
Right. That's right. And you know what? And, you know, within the system, and as sad as it is, you know, and seeing that kind of dynamic where you have grandfathers that was incarcerated, now the son is coming through the system, now the grandson is coming through the system. But in that same token, you have these prison officials or prison guards and officers, so on and so forth. A lot of them have made careers and livings and sending their children to, you know, college and universities and educating their children off of the backs of these incarcerated individuals. So you may have an individual that's a captain that's in the prison, right? And his son is a lieutenant,
right.
And then the other son is a sergeant, and then the other son that's graduating high school, they got an officer job earmarked for him as soon as he graduates. Mm-hmm. So in the same token where our generations are going through the same process of being incarcerated, their generations are making a living off our incarceration.
Yeah, we're in Jersey, right? And I was just talking to my people today about really understanding the dynamics of incarceration, the rules, regulations in Jersey. But when we look at it in our city, we call up north state prison, right?
Right.
Because most of New York, so if you're from the five boroughs of New York City, Brooklyn, Bronx, Queens, Staten Island, and Manhattan. Rikers is the main facility. Each one probably got a detention center in that borough.
Right. Okay.
But once you get sentenced, you go to state prison.
Right.
All of the state prisons are upstate New York.
Right.
In white neighborhoods. Everybody in there is white, incest, family, all of that, right?
Right.
Prison industrial complex business, which is license plates and clothing and all that, is ran by them, right? So slavery at a different level. Whereas if you're doing a job in there, you're talking about 14 cents to 20 something cents per hour, right? To make furniture, eyeglasses,
right?
While you see them promoting that, pushing that modern day slavery. Right. So it's just shifted differently.
Yeah, those numbers, they put those type of numbers in those communities for a reason. And that's because when tax time come and they're looking for budgeting for the city, they actually add the inmates in the population of the city. Though they're not operating and moving through the city and they're not free to do nothing, they actually count them in. So they get more money in and it ends up going to their school budgets and it ends up, you know what I'm saying, going towards their parks being built and their neighborhoods being built. And that's crazy because, it's modern day slavery because it's off the back of us, literally off the back of us.
Well, you know, the dynamic in New Jersey as far as the prison situation, and most cities have their own county jail, or the county, that particular county have their own county jail. So when you first get locked up, you go into the county jail. Now, once you get sentenced to time, we call it going down. Y'all call it going up north, we call it going down. That means you got sent down to prison. And most of the prisons are in like rural communities, you know, that sit off in industrial communities, because a lot of the city, you have a couple of them that are in cities, but a lot of the people in the cities, they fight against prisons being in their cities. So that's why they build a lot of them in industrial or rural areas where there's not a lot of population of people at, you know. So that's the dynamic with the prison in New Jersey. But to get back to the topic, like I said, that's the second phase of the criminalities in the criminal system. You have the criminal act, then you have the detention, and then you have the incarceration. And then the next phase is for those that are fortunate enough to have the type of time where they will one day be released back into society, because not everybody has that opportunity. Because I know I left a lot of guys behind the wall that got, they sentence ain't numbers, is letters. Mm-hmm. You know, they got life. They never coming home. They never going to walk the streets again. They'll never have the opportunity to be at their daughter's wedding, to walk their daughter down the aisle, to watch their son graduate. You know, if their son happen to play ball and go pro, they won't be there to watch their son sign a pro contract. You know, they'll never have that opportunity again. You know, these guys, the reality is that a lot of them are probably going to die in prison. Mm-hmm. You know, so for those individuals that don't have that kind of time and that has the opportunity to one day return to society, now we have to go into the next phase of the criminal process, which is re-entry. Mm-hmm. All right, making your transition from doing time and preparing this individual to go back into society to try and become a productive individual in society again. All right, which is another whole, you know, monster in itself. You know what I'm saying? Now, this is the thing. At one time, there used to be, I don't know about in New York, in New Jersey, there used to be a lot of programs in the prison system that was geared toward rehabilitating these individuals, helping them out. Right. You know, go to school, get your GED, you know, take college courses, alcohol and drug counseling, you know, pick up a trade to try to increase your chances of success when you get back out. But a lot of those programs have been stripped out of the prison system. They've taken them away or they stopped funding them. Right. So now, basically, you go to prison for 10, 15, 20 years, you basically could sit in your cell and just do nothing for the whole 15, 20 years, and then on the day of time for the release, you just let them go with a $60 check and drop them off at the train station.
You're going to work then. That's like, yeah. You best believe that. You're going to work
then. Yeah, you're going to make me work. Right. When you're going to the box.
Right.
Right. Remember, you're state property. Mm. So you don't have a, you don't own yourself. A lot of people don't understand that.
Right.
Right, you can't even play with yourself without violating the rule. That's a mm-hmm. rule violation.
Right.
Right. So in state prison, they need that money to promote that business.
Right.
Right. It's a business. I changed being a consumer to that business, prison industrial complex. So when you look at our state prisons, you look at the fact that when you talk about rehabilitation, that step, there's no rehabilitation in incarceration.
Right.
New York State prison has got one or two community-based organizations inside those prisons, one or two. Mm-hmm. Right? And the problem with incarceration in our prisons is the mass majority are just put together, regardless of crime, time, and certain facilities, just right. whatever. And I always tell the young people when I talk that my time in jail for my first day back, the two prison sentences state, 3 years both. The first time was robbery, and I went up there, and that shit that I didn't do,
right.
I changed my crime, right, on when I came home. I didn't come home, remember, I'm angry. I didn't come home wanting to
right.
do better. I came home saying, I'm upset now, you know, put me in a system around dudes who are older than me. I'm doing 3 years. I went through 4 or 5 maximum facility prisons, mm-hmm. around a bunch of lifers, and that wasn't good for an 18-year-old.
Right.
So I came home with a different mindset and went directly into selling drugs.
Right.
Right, and that sent me back to prison. So you look at state prison, we have to start rehabilitating our way, getting inside those facilities and rehabilitate early.
Right.
State prison, they got what's called phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, once you get towards the end of your sentence.
Right.
It's not enough. It's not helping. right? You're not preparing a man who just did 15 years and he met his girl while doing 15 years, never lived with her, day in his life. Now he got to come home and coexist with her in a home,
right?
That he got paroled to, that's his only option.
Right.
But he been living with dudes for 15 years.
Right.
When I first came home, I was in my shower, in my bathroom, in my boxers. And there was nobody else in my bathroom.
Right.
But I was so accustomed to not getting a shower in state prison that I didn't even catch that. You know what I'm saying? Right. Yeah. We talking about that, how are we starting to transition the minds to prepare people before they get out, not waiting until that last minute.
Right.
We need long-term programs. If you got 15 years and you 5 years to come home, we should be working on you 5 years to come home,
right?
And that's what we got to start talking about. We're talking about rehabilitation. Reentry has to start much faster than a year before you come home.
I agree with that. And you know what? You know what? You know what's the crazy is ironic that you said that about the boxer thing. You know, because I've spoken to a lot of individuals that did long periods of incarceration, and they go through those things where it's like you got to be debriefed. You know, like a veteran going to war, like a military individual going to war overseas and being gone a long time and experiencing all of this murder and chaos and, you know, frontline fighting and watching, you know, people next to you get blowed up with bombs and all that. So when they come back from war, they got to go through a debriefing. You know what I'm saying? Because a lot of them are suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome, you know, disorder. And they messed up and they got to be debriefed to get them out of war mode back into normal mode. Exactly. And with incarceration, you know, it's the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, you got to be debriefed from being in, see, because when you're in prison mode, see, in prison, it's a tense environment. Anything can happen at any time. I mean, we could be sitting in the mess hall and eating breakfast, and then dude get poked in the neck, right, and blood all in your damn pancakes and sausage, and you like, what the hell? Somebody getting stabbed right there, right next to you. Like, it happens so suddenly and so quick. You know, that's a traumatic event to experience.
The whole jail.
Right. The whole
traumatic.
Right. The whole prison process.
Traumatic.
Right.
Experience.
Being strip searched after visit. Having other men, you know, looking at you. True. And,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Spread your butt cheeks and all that stuff.
Yeah,
right. It's a squat, right. So guys coming home from incarceration need that same debriefing that military individuals need when they coming from war.
Right.
So you need to get out of prison mode and get back into family mode. You know why? Because you're about to go back into society where there's women, children, and all that other stuff. You're not around the killers, gorillas, and monsters no more, where you got to walk around with a banger all day, you know, ready to poke somebody up, or you got to be on point, you know, because you rolling with this set of dudes and the other set over there beefing with them, so they trying to get y'all trying to get them, you know, you got to be on point at all times, because anything happens at any time.
Right.
Going in the shower, just going in the shower to wash your ass could be life and death situation.
Your last time.
You see what I'm saying? So, these guys need to be debriefed, and again, there are facilities here in New Jersey, I don't know about in New York, where at one time they used to let the guys go after you finish your time, you go straight from the prison right home. Now they don't allow that, you know, you go through, you have the ability to go to assessment centers now, where they give you that debriefing, where they assess you to determine your suitability for reentry back into society.
Who is they?
They have counselors, they have licensed social workers, they have clinical psychologists.
How many of them been arrested before?
Probably not a lot of them.
Then they're not the right people.
Right. Probably not a lot of them.
So when I came home and I started doing my work, and I went my work into, you know, as a gangster, right? It wasn't to glamorize it. It was to recognize something I was. And how do I attack that? How do I change the mindset? I didn't go into drugs, right? I didn't go into starting to do work around heroin. Like, I ain't never did heroin. So I can't relate to somebody that's using heroin. I don't know how to really. I could read a book to tell me about it, but I didn't experience that.
You can't relate to it.
No.
You're not personally related to
it. Correct.
Right.
It's easier to be yourself when taking on certain roles, so you can be able to express your point easier to a person because they see where you at. It's automatically a bond that's connected.
Fact.
Like, I see where this brother at. He's at the same place I was at. I understand that. It's a disconnection when a person hasn't gone through that same experience.
And they just have the book experience.
Yeah.
Personal
life experience is what really connects in those type of situations, because there's an understanding, so you can comprehend what that person is going through and you can give them the proper advice on how to move.
And the formerly incarcerated, can any formerly incarcerated people have these licenses?
Yes.
Yes, they're allowed to get that, yes.
Right, it's the same difference, right? Mm-hmm. Now you trump the game because you have the experience and the education.
Right.
And that's what we should be focused on, removing the people who just got it and don't understand our dynamics of the issues we're going through, because all they see us is criminal, right? They're criminalizing.
Yes.
And we're trying to change the direction of it and focus on public health. These are mental issues, right? This is systematic trauma. We're talking about years of slavery. The Jews have looked at the Holocaust and ran with it. We looked at slavery and started killing ourselves more, right? Mm-hmm. This deep rooted trauma in our community for years. So we have to really look at the fact now that you go into an incarcerated state to come home, we have to really prepare you on many avenues, right? And that's what we have to do. For example, somebody might come home and now they was the man and now they want to come home and now they want to take the hood back. Right. And that's causing upkeep and violence in our communities because the hood changed. You need to know that.
Yeah, right, yeah, right.
Who you was, guess what? They don't want to hear that right now, right? Yeah, so we got rehabilitation and reentry looks really different for our communities.
That's a fact. Yeah, so, you know, I mean, and like I said, you know, we have the assessment centers, you know, and so on and so forth. The halfway houses also play a role, you know, with reentry back into society. So a lot of guys are afforded the opportunity to make it to a halfway house where they can be able to go out in the street and work, go to school, go to college, try to further their education, whatever it is that they choose to engage in as part of their reentry back into society. So it's like a halfway mark between being home and still being incarcerated. Mm-hmm. But you got more freedom than you have as say you were behind the wall. You're out in society, and most of the halfway houses are in urban communities. You know, that's the difference, like with the prisons. The prisons are mostly in rural communities, but most of the halfway houses are right there in the hood, you know, in urban communities, mm-hmm. where you could come out to go to work, you know, and see your mans and them across the street, like, yo, what up, bro? But now there's also rules, you know, and you have to be accountable for where you at all times. You have to make itineraries where you're supposed to be at work at this time, and you're not supposed to deviate from that. If you do and you get caught, you get returned back to prison, you know. So, I mean, and then also there's a dynamic of these halfway houses being in urban communities. Sometimes old street beef come back to get you while you in there.
Street influence is one of the hardest things. You walking to go to your job and you see your man and they all up in the Benz and all that.
Right.
And they instantly like, yo, you coming back? Like, bro, I'm trying to do right. Nah, but is you coming back?
Right.
Before you know it, you're trying to leave the halfway house to go start balling again.
Add to that, that's another thing that we focus on, right? We look at incarceration, right? From what you just said, right? Now, there's an addiction there that we don't attach to ourselves, right? And that addiction is a lifestyle, right? And what we say that is, what you just explained about he coming home, he in a halfway house that's right there in his community.
Right.
He started to see people, right? That right there is a trigger to get back into your old ways.
Yes.
If you don't have the right support system around that.
Very important.
Right?
Yes.
I put you in a halfway house where you live, you start seeing that son and all, they getting his money now. Right. This halfway thing ain't working for me.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Right? Now they recognize, oh, that's such and such. Now they're going to offer you something, and then you right back into it, right? So there's a support network that has to happen for someone who's in those transitional facilities. New York really focuses on, don't have halfway houses. That's more federal in New York City.
Gotcha.
Okay. Right? So if you do state time, it's if you're going through work release, that's the only time you get anywhere near that. But it's New York state time, there's no halfway houses.
Let me just make another quick point before we introduce our guest that just stepped in. So we can get his take on a lot of the stuff that we've been talking about and bring him up to speed. Now, also, which is very important with that incarceration aspect and coming out and stuff and so on and so forth. And like you said, having a support system to keep you grounded, be able to keep you grounded. Now, one of the things that people have to understand, incarcerated individuals, when you've been out of the mix for a while, all right, you haven't been productively working, you know, and making money and being in a position where you can maintain and take care of a family. A lot of these guys have to understand, because what happens to them, a lot of times they get put under pressure to be a breadwinner again as soon as they come home. All right, and what that does is that pushes you back into your old lifestyle again. All right, because you just coming home from doing 5, 10, 15 years, now you back out there, you move in with this woman, and now she expecting you to start paying rent within a month.
or two after you just got home, you know, they're expecting you to start paying child support. They're expecting you to start maintaining, you know, lifestyle that they was living while you was gone. So what that does is it puts you under the gun and under pressure. So if you don't immediately have employment that's readily available to you, you're going to go back to what you know best. All right, I'm going to pick this pack up. Let me hit my man Shawn up. He got a pack for me. You know, let me hit my man Face up. You know what I'm saying? Your Face. I need a ratchet, man. Because I want to go back to these stick-ups now because I need to put a few dollars in my pocket. Because old girl rent is due. You know, baby needs some shoes. You know, Mom Dukes needs some help with a public service. And I ain't got no job yet, so I'm going to go back and do what I do because I just seen some cats on the block down there that got some jewelry on. Look like they got a few dollars in their pocket. So I'm going to do what I do best. So don't allow yourself to be pressured into trying to become a breadwinner in a household when you just now touching and you don't have the resources to get you there.
Get yourself right.
All
right,
take your time, you know, because at the end of the day, if you won't work on yourself and you ain't right, it ain't nothing you could do for nobody else. No kids, no woman, or none of that. And let's be clear, a lot of what guys are incarcerated, a lot of it is directly related to women. And I just want to put that out there.
Man.
Whether you try, listen, I don't mean that. Don't take it the wrong way, sisters. Don't take it the wrong way.
Man. Let me just hold up, Shawn. That's them having self-esteem problems.
Yeah, self-esteem, but listen, a lot of it has to do with guys trying to impress women.
No, I don't know about that.
The jewelry, the car.
No, that's self-esteem.
Okay,
come on, Shawn. Woman, man.
Come on in.
That's nothing to do with a female.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyway, I sold drugs. I sold drugs because my mother was on drugs. I had no father.
Right.
I mean, that's I got in a drug trade now. Me wearing jewelry because that's what part of the culture that was back then.
Right.
I was part of a drug culture. I mean today they might do that today for these females.
Right.
But I'm going to 40 years old from my cup of a drug culture.
Right.
I mean when we sold drugs because this was the only way. So we knew today they got this thing on young people to do.
Right.
But now I ain't never sold no drug. I'm saying so I'm gonna sell this drug. Depressed no female. Nah, man, I ain't going that one, homie.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I mean like they doing that because they want to do it.
Mm-hmm.
Feel me? And when they later on, they want to press the female, they want them, and they might kill a female.
Right.
Feel me? But they selling drugs. Feel me? Sometimes back then, it's because of the rhyme you went.
Yeah,
so I grew up in them saying with real projects.
Right.
At that time.
Elizabeth,
New Jersey.
Okay.
Finding homes.
So I mean,
these are real projects.
Right.
Back then, we're saying, so it was a different era. When you growing up with drugs was infested in there.
Right.
If I mean, you know, the drug dealers took care of the neighborhood, and everybody knew his position.
Right.
He knew that was his job. I mean, he didn't know when he grew into it.
Right.
I mean, but today, I mean, you might find some dudes. I'm saying, I might, you know, beat on girls. I'm saying, a lot of things are going high dealing with young individuals because they don't know how to control themselves and they're on a lot of emotional pills.
Right.
So they might do that today, but a lot of dudes are not getting money, young dudes.
What's up? Right. So, I wouldn't say that. And I always talk about this. When you look at, if you go past a schoolyard, right now, and you just watch our young boys and girls in the streets playing with each other, you see the boy and the girl play fighting, right? Mm-hmm. I came up in the same era. Play fighting meant I liked you.
Yep.
Right? That's how we expressed
our... I might still do that.
You know, that comes from slavery. That come from them beating us, and now we thinking that's the way to show we love each other. Now our kids is coming up believing. So now if you a young kid, and I met you in junior high school, when I met you play fighting and punching you up, and then eventually we get into a relationship, I'm going to keep doing the same thing when I'm up. That's what it is. It's systematic.
Right. But everything is really systematic. We've been past. We don't even stick together. You know what I'm saying? We're going to talk about slavery. We're going to talk about ancient things. They stuck together more as slaves back then, the ones who's out there trying to survive and get back.
Right.
I mean, that case and that should have led all the way from slavery. You know what I'm saying? That we should stick together. Feel me? Like, a lot of things, slavery fucked us up. I'm not going to deny that. That shit is like a trauma forever. Mm-hmm. And we don't know how to hold each other down. I mean, but back then, if you watched the slave movie, read the books or whatever, they stuck together in the field because that's all they had.
Right.
Feel me? Later on, when we start letting people get into our mix, ain't no saying get into our ears, and then it becomes divide and conquer. Can't you know what I'm saying? That's what came.
They offer a better. They offer something better than that.
We
everyone
thought,
else is getting.
We thought.
They come to you and say, "Hey, I'm
gonna
give you something better than what they're getting," and that's where the divide comes.
That still goes on today. You know what I'm saying? You could be cool with
that's
a dude.
A fact, Kanye.
You could be cool with a dude. Right. And you know what I'm saying? Y'all could be getting money together.
Right.
And soon as one person comes to him, thing changes. You got to be like a firm person. Like, why are you even talking to me about him?
Right.
For me, like, we across each other over nothing. For me, over clout, over anything. We across each other quick.
And it's ironic that we're talking about that in light of, you know, what just recently happened with Brother Nipsey out there on the West Coast. You know, and again, it's just an example that no matter who you are or what level of life you on, you know what I'm saying, at any time you're involved or distill around that element in urban communities, you could become a victim of that.
But you always going to be a victim of that.
Right, exactly.
I was about to say that can actually happen.
Yeah, remember, like, you know what I'm saying? He's still in the hood. He's still representing the culture, what he believes in. The set. But when you out there in them streets like that, we're dealing with a hatred.
Right.
So, I mean, a hatred, not for you. Like, people, like, we hate the next girl you may have. We hate the next person because, like, we might feel like I should have what he had.
Right. It's a hate for
self. Where coming from? Like, when you do that, that's hate.
Seen it. But our arrogance, like, nigga ain't gonna do nothing to me. I got 100 shooters.
All right, Shawn, listen. I want to ask you a question. But before I ask you the question, first we're gonna get into a little bit about your movement, which is a very strong and powerful movement and a powerful message that you got. Now, we're going to let you make a formal introduction. You can tell the people who you are, a little bit about your movement and what it is that you do. All right?
My name is Kanye West.
Right. So, Shawn, tell us, you know, give us your name. Let the people know who you are.
My name is
the name of your movement.
My name is Shawn Hartwell. I'm from Lisbon, New Jersey. I was incarcerated for 20 years for a kid kingpin charge. I came home. I knew I couldn't sell drugs no more. That was an option in my brain before I got here.
Right.
I'm telling you the truth. But an old time, my man Blue, the legend from Brooklyn, he told me if you sell drugs again, they're going to hang you from where you find us. You see a tree outside the courthouse, they might tell me one when you get back, but they're going to hang your ass from there.
Right.
Go out there and try the party thing. So, you know, I'm like, oh, you know, I might give it a shot. So I read a few books about it, and I came home, I started my LLC, I'm in the joint. You know what I'm saying? I got out here, done a party, my party's Blue.
Right.
And then about, like, going to, like, you know, like, I was dealing with different situations. My son got incarcerated.
Right.
Feds locked some of my family up.
Right.
So, you know, I'm floating through life. I'm saying, still doing my parties. And then one day, you know, I had to start a fuck your prisoner. To make a long story short, I had an argument with a person. He told me he ain't got a problem going back to jail. And I was like, you know, like, nigga, are you fucking serious, my nigga? Like, we did done 20 years.
Right.
Who the fuck want to go to prison? You crazy nigga.
Right.
And I was just talking. Somebody recorded it.
Right.
So I just made a page off it. And from there, I was just making pages, you know, making videos and doing that. And everybody was laughing at me, like, why the fuck, you know, he's saying, like, tell people not to go to jail. I'm not telling you not to hustle.
Right.
I'm not never going to tell no one how to feed their family. I'm just saying, like, if you're driving in the car and the light is out and you have no registration, you ain't got no license, you get pulled over in Bloomfield, New Jersey.
Right.
You got a chop and two keys in the car. Right. My nigga, like, who the fuck went with
him?
Like, come on,
exactly.
You knew goddamn well you shouldn't have been doing that right there.
Yeah,
for me, like, then you're gonna blame on the white man just pulled me over.
Mm-hmm.
And you got tents in your car with a light off in Bloomfield, New Jersey.
Right.
Nah,
right.
Man, you put yourself in that predicament. Right. It's not the police fault. He has a job.
Right.
That's his job. You have a job.
Right.
For me, and I'm saying, who the fuck gonna go to prison? Now, with the killing going on, I disagree on that. For me, I don't agree on killing. People might think because I come from that culture and my background,
right,
and my son is incarcerated, was got charged with two murders,
right,
and beat him. Then I agree on that. I don't agree on murders. I don't believe on taking life after this earth. I'm not a killer.
Right.
Feel me? I get money.
Right.
That's what I do for a living. I'm a hustler. I don't believe in that. I don't snap that. I don't believe no more. I don't believe kids should be out before their parents. That's my belief.
Right.
Feel me? And that's my belief.
Right.
I'm saying, I don't think you should do just take someone's child off this earth. But we all know when you're playing this game,
right,
there's issues, there's situations going to come up. You're playing this game, there's no friends. You're going to die,
right,
or go to prison.
Right.
And when I learned that myself, I went to prison.
Right.
Most of my friends are dead, and some of them are still in prison. And that's just the game.
Right.
Feel me? If you want to play this game, this comes with the game.
Right.
And I told my son the other day, that comes with the game. I told my man the other day, see, your son just got killed. He knew what he was doing. That comes with the game.
Right.
And my son get killed, that comes with the game.
Gotcha.
I knew what I was in.
Right.
He knew what he was dealing with. I'm not going to sit here and be like, oh, they killed my son. I'm going to cry, but that come, you play.
He was playing. Mm-hmm. Right.
You feel me? If you play, they going to play on you.
Right.
If I'm going to keep all 1-100 with you.
Right.
When I got my 20 years, I called my grandmother. yeah, now they hard on me and it's that. Ho, nigga.
But
I said the tough nigga talking to me like that. Right. You beat up the church man over by McDonald's. Right. You done this and robbed that. You sold it. I don't hear that shit now, nigga. Right. Stiffen up in there.
Right.
Don't call me with that bullshit, nigga. Like you was a good boy out here.
Right.
And she gave it to me raw. Let me know right then. I don't want to hear that. Ain't the Nah, she go. You crying?
Right.
And let me get it together. I don't want to cut you off, but let me just make a point real quick because you know, and it's ironic that. Touching that before I get to the question I want to ask you, because you see a lot of parents are younger nowadays compared to when I was coming up, you know.
Very much.
Parents was older, our parents was like 25, 30 years older than the kids, but there's a close relation between the kids and parents nowadays. And with that being said, a lot of these young parents out here either are party to, condone, or know about their children's lifestyle.
No, a lot of them don't know.
No, but listen, hear me out, Shawn, real quick. I've been in situations where I know parents that would tell you, my son will kill your motherfucking ass. Play with me if you want.
Oh, yeah, they
you know what I'm saying? A lot of parents know how their kids get down. Yeah. And they rock with it. You see what I'm saying? So now when the chickens come home to roost, you got to eat that bullet. You know what I'm saying? So if your son out there or your daughter out there and they living in the lifestyle, they hustling, selling drugs, on the block, doing whatever, and that lifestyle comes back to haunt them in whatever way it does, then, like you said, it comes with the game.
And that's what I don't like about people, like even parents. All your females, or even people that know what they man, or only the people into.
Right.
Like you might, you know, you have a female, or you are, or your mother might know what you're into, then you get locked up. Here it is. Where the fuck you think all this money was coming from?
Right.
Yeah. Like, what do you think I was into?
Yeah.
You think I was, now I catch a case.
Right.
Everybody acting like they don't know what the hell is going on no more.
Right.
I mean, this comes with the game, baby girl. Right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you fuck with me, I'm in the streets.
Right.
I'm likely to go to jail.
Right.
This is the game.
Right.
Now, what position are you going to play? Are you going to play this position? Right. Let me know now that I can know how to rock. Don't be telling me, like, I love you, don't want you to be messing with the girls, all that. And so I get knocked off.
And
you
then it's off
now,
the
now, come on, like, what we doing here? Well, coming from, like, this game is this. To me, the whole drug trade is fucked up.
Right.
But, I mean, I don't suggest no one even sell drugs. Because right. most dudes you get packs through the day, they're going to run off with your pack. Let's get that clip right now. I mean, like, no one want no real money.
Right.
I mean, so I would suggest that the new way of money is like, you know, like, what we call, like, when I was in jail, people were like, yeah, man, this lame nigga got my girl. Who's the lame nigga? He got a job. Now, we're the lame niggas.
Right.
We in this motherfucker. You
that's
crazy?
Right. That's right.
I mean, like, so I would suggest, if you are here today, get into internet, get into real estate, get into the thing, or just get you a plain old JOB.
Right.
Feel me? And just take it from there. And because you'll make more money, less stress. Right. You'll be more at peace. Feel me? Of what you're doing, just getting a job, finding a way to hustle, or owning your own business.
Right.
It's more, less stressful. When you're in that drug trade, like culture, I know it. Feel me? You can't sleep.
Right.
You're going to drink half the time and be high half the time because you don't know when they're coming.
Right.
Because they're coming one day.
Right.
From anything that's you do every day, they come. That's a fact.
That's a fact.
Because there's no one out here. If I'm wearing mad jewelry out here shining, and soon you get pulled over, you don't even know who the hell I am. You just seen, but I can tell you some shit now. Mm-hmm. Nigga Shawn, he do be. I see him all the time at this girl house. I don't really know him, but he be at this girl house. He's selling drugs. Right. Blah, blah, blah. Mm-hmm. Next thing you know, I'm not fuck off. Because
right.
you, I don't know, can't do no goddamn mm-hmm. time. Right. And that's just the game. Feel me? And like they know what you're doing, it's just about a minor time where they're gonna come get you.
Right.
They definitely know what you're doing, they definitely know what you're into. It's nothing no secret today. Before you might get a sold drug, you might know where you at, you might shit. Today, they know what you're doing.
Yes.
It's when they're gonna come get you. When you're out of time, they come get you.
Right.
They're coming. You on their list, definitely on your list.
Right.
And you know what I'm saying? I don't been since I've been home, my phone been tapped 7 times. Feel me? And I, you know, they still trying to get me.
Right.
But they don't want to believe that I'm doing no parties. That nigga ain't doing no goddamn. That nigga's a kingpin. That nigga, you know, like to sell drugs.
So listen, I got a question.
They still tap my phone.
So at what point? So we're wise enough. Many of you guys are wise enough because you've been through it to understand some of that. So at what point, and what is it that we're supposed to? What's our responsibility to minimize those numbers? Because it's our communities that's affected the most, right?
To minimize the numbers of incarceration.
Of our young people getting put in those positions. Like, are we responsible to
no, you can't say that. You can't say that.
For the community.
So, them young kids want money. And half of the shit we talking about, I went to Scared Straight all night telling people, get the fuck out of my
face. Yeah, but who was that Scared Straight, though? Like,
there was some people in there.
Nah, that's not, I don't jack no said Scared Straight.
No, I went to all the programs.
Right.
You know what I mean? And it might have said a few people, but
What you into, you into. For me, like, sometimes you gotta get burnt on yourself, so you gotta learn. I had to learn on my own. Now, I see a young boy, I can give him my advice.
Right.
Mr. Playboy, I know you out here playing.
Do you feel obligated, though? Do you feel like...
Always obligated, okay. Because OGs, the older dudes, teach the younger generation. They gave me the advice.
They lost. Okay.
They would see me, and I would ask them a question, like, how you do 13 years in prison? I could never do 13 years in prison, homie.
Right.
I've done 20 in prison, more than him. He would give me his advice, like, you can do it, you got to do it, you got the choice.
Mm-hmm. Right.
He said, but this is the game you win, you playing. You have to get out the game.
Right.
For me, like, I tell a lot of young dudes, I hear them. The ones I know that's doing some shit in the streets, I would see them, be like, yo, they saying shit about you. Now they ain't saying, nah, you, nigga. You, they saying you. You behind all that shit going on.
Right.
I'm telling you, they gonna come get your ass. Chill out. For me, I give them advice. I don't have to do that, come on my business. Yeah. For me, he might tell me, nigga, get the fuck out my face.
But sometimes, yeah, because words ain't enough. You know, like I mean, come on, you figure in some of the situations, and I don't want to put a blanket over everybody, right? But in a large number of the situations, you imagine there are no, like, father figures, right? So you can't tell a young man that's out here getting money nothing.
First of all, they don't even hear what you're talking about, but if you, they get some money.
Yeah, they not trying to hear you.
They're not even a man, right? You're a good man. You get some money. They might take some advice from you. If they feel like you're cool.
Okay, that's my point.
And you're like, you should be cool? One of them.
Everybody likes Shawn.
Everybody
likes Trey, right?
Yeah, but the difference with me is that's not my job.
Okay.
My job isn't to tell nobody how to get money or not to get money.
Right.
Kind of like Shawn said, right? We don't know the environment. We don't know the home.
Right.
And depending on what happens, that person may be the controller of that home and that finances
right.
the house.
Right.
And that's why you got the mother that says, yo, my son will kill you.
Right.
Because
right.
she know right. the father son. Been gone and she put him out there. She actually right. put the son in the street mm-hmm. to get to that.
Yeah. Right. Right.
So I learned not to focus on nobody's resources on okay. how they should get their money. Right?
Right.
We deal with a lot of scamming. That's major.
Right.
That causes a lot of violence.
Right.
So what I focus on is the individual and violence. That's my focus. Right. How do
yes.
I stop violence from happening?
Because
I can stop that. Right. I can tell you how not to shoot. I ain't going to tell you about your money. So now that plays in part where I'm saying, homie, if you shooting, you ain't going to get that money. Right. Because if people are dying, then it's hot out here. Right. That's just my way of dealing with those
right.
that's on that block. Right.
Yeah.
But most importantly, that's what I focus on. You're shooting, right? I come from that lifestyle, right? I've been charged with shootings. I've been arrested. Like I said, my arrest is 18 arrests in total, mm-hmm. 13 years in installments. I'm known for that lifestyle, for violence.
Mm-hmm.
So to be able to get out there and say, nah, don't do that, right? There's a difference there because I'm not far from it. I'm still who I am,
mm-hmm.
right? Versus an OG coming home to my used to sell drugs, so they don't sell drugs. It's not the same thing,
mm-hmm.
right? I could be violent today just like anybody else, but I choose not to be.
Right.
So that's the dynamics of what I focus on in my community. By showing you now, let's say you are the one who's the shooter. I'm telling you, just like showing that if you shoot, you know you're going to jail, bro. Like there's nothing else there, homie. I'm telling you, I was just there. There's dudes right now crying to get out from behind themselves. They'll do anything for another bag of chips that they could walk to the store and get. You don't
right.
want that, right? So now, when I get that conversation around violence, now I can talk about what's causing you to be violent, right? And if it's employment or if it's the work that you're involved in, the hustling that you're involved in.
Why is that even employment today, bro?
No, that's what I'm saying. It's different. It's not everybody got different issues, right? And that's what I'm talking about. Somebody just want to do it because they just, I had dudes that, they got the mother, father got good jobs, and they the worst person on the block.
Right.
Right.
Right. I was just talking to your niece about that. But listen, I think in order to stem back
the numbers in the population, it has to be a unified thing. It has to be cohesive, not just us as parents and our race and our communities. It has to be done in the public school system. It has to be done because these kids are influenced by so much nowadays. The video, the hip-hop
bro.
Culture,
hip-hop TV. Culture got them twisted.
Yeah, it got them right. twisted. I mean, like, they
bug
out.
Culture,
right.
Instagram got them twisted. That's why I always tell people,
right.
like I had a name before Instagram. Instagram
right.
didn't make me.
Right.
I'm saying, like, I made my name in the streets. Like I was stamped.
Yes,
mm-hmm. right. I come forth.
We ain't had no Instagram, bro.
Yeah, I could move where somebody had to stamp me. Like I
would
move
where
I would do is people had to stamp me.
Right.
But coming from like
you had to get on the block to sell your first tag.
We got stamped. Who the fuck are you, nigga?
Right.
For me, like you had to fight or get
right.
something.
Yeah. Right.
You know, the dude could get a name on Instagram, say I'm Joe Blow.
and do a viral video of him saying and he's a man and this and that and that. But he has no culture.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? He's not breaking down. You can tell when a dude gets some money or a dude gets something, the way he acts, right. What's his upbringing, you can't tell. It's like, you know, even when I was in the streets, I still had like a church base for my grandmother. But coming from, like, I still was like things I wouldn't do.
Right.
So I'm like,
right.
I'm not going to do that right there, but I'm going to do this right here.
Right.
Or I would know better. And if I knew better, I just said, fuck, I'm going to do it. I'm going to have the consequences that come with it.
Right.
I mean, but you knew better. Right. Today, you can see that all balance of a lot of people when the things they do it for clout. They do it for different reasons.
Right.
Where coming from, and that's just how the world is today. You can't even say everybody clout chasing, everybody want clout.
Right.
I'm saying everybody's trying to get ahead in this game. You can't even say that.
Like, what's the separation between the older generation and the young generation?
There's no respect.
Listen, when I was coming up, the OGs gave us, you had to have a rite of passage to come out, like Shawn just said.
Right.
The OGs, number one, they gave us the rules to the game. Listen, you can't be out here doing that. You can't do this. You can't treat women like this. You can't be busting guns on the block. You can't do that. They'll chase you out of there. Punching them out. You're
preaching to the choir. Right. Preaching to the choir because right. We're all in the same age and generation, right? We'll all say the same thing that. Right. The OGs told us this, and that, right?
No, we ain't teaching.
Exactly what I was going to say, bro. We didn't play it different. We got it, we took it, and we ran with it,
no,
right?
We played it different
and we didn't
too.
Focus on them. And what they did was watched us, went on the internet,
right.
And made up their own ways, right? That's what happened. We didn't turn back. That's what I'm doing. I'm turning back around and say, hold up, come back, homie. Troy, I don't care who your big homie is. You're bugging. That's not the way, right?
Right.
Because I was in a situation, I talk about it, you know, I got a book coming out, you read on it, where there was a situation where I was waiting to shoot a dude, that me and him was in a shootout, and I'm waiting, but I couldn't shoot him because there was a crackhead talking to him, and I had to wait for that crackhead to leave, right? And that's different because in today's generation, they don't hear about none of that. Mm-hmm. They gonna shoot whoever. Yeah, they gonna shoot. That's, I got that from Coles and Tesla, even though I was committing a heinous act.
It was to, old school
there
rules.
Was certain rules to it that I abided by, right? That's not here no more.
Like, you know, like I said before, people ask me, right?
Tell them who's on the board. Go in the room. Why is it right on that screen?
Like, people ask me, right? Let me break down to people for president. I'm going to break down to a few things that I'm doing for president.
Right.
For president means, like, you know, jail is a hard statement.
Right.
And people say, well, you know, you should change it to go into schools. You should change it so they can get in school. I'm going to change shit. Right. You know, and I'm Nipsey Hussle set the bar.
Right.
Tell you that. He was he never denied he was a gang member.
Right.
He never denied what he represented.
Right.
And the president of the United States sent him a letter, and at the end of the day, he was a gang member.
Right.
Boy, now, he done great things for the community, for the gang member, the way he done it. And he set the bar in saying that you can do whatever you want.
Go ahead, talk
for me. You just gotta believe in it and just do it.
Right. Yeah.
From the heart. Right. And he set the bar for that. Perfect example. His brother got up there and said, I've done this for the set.
Right.
For me, like, and so that, you know, he's a gang member and he set the bar saying that I can do whatever I want dealing with my fucking prison. And I've been telling people I could do that. That don't make me change anything.
Right.
This is what I represent.
Right.
And he went in schools and he spoke like that. I feel the same way. So I kept the harsh word, fuck you prison, because going to jail is a hard situation.
Yes, right.
It's not a light situation. You know, oh, I could say damn prison, but fuck you prison, like what the fuck would it really be in here?
Right.
Yeah. It's a harsh word.
So
and that's a harsh reality.
Yes.
I got my organization, this Gangsters Making National Community Change. Right? When I came out I had to use that word. I went into a lot of places where they laughed at me.
Of course.
Right? Alright, now I got two offices. One in East Flatbush, one in Fort Wayne, and 20-something employees. Right?
Yes.
And I ain't never changed who I am. I bring that to my community, right? I'm coming as I am to make that change, right? Same difference. With all due respect to the bro, we all have these bitches, just like fuck you, right? Fuck who wants to fuck go to prison. That whole concept has to be, because I jacked that even before I met you. It is what it is, homie.
Yeah, right? I gotta keep it like that.
Yeah, that, you know, they want you to change it up. My mother said to me when I first told her about my organization, she said, son, you're not a gangster. What's the word I try to sound like with that? You know, no, mom, you don't understand. I'm not glamorizing it, right? I'm trying to show you that this is something that society made me of, right? And it's an addiction and a mindset that we have to change, and I have to attack it by identifying the mindset and addiction of the lifestyle,
right?
Gangster mentality is fast money, cars, drugs, jewelry, all that stuff, that violence, all that comes into one part, and we have to deal with it differently, And that's my focus, right? How do we focus on the mental, right? The thing that told me it's okay to shoot, right? That's a learned behavior. Right. And now we got to teach our unlearn that behavior to our communities.
Right. Right. Well, now, so now, Shawn, back now, to you.
Fucking prison, so now, I took it from them.
Right.
And then when I went to up in the Complex Com and I dealt with, I saw Pusha T. And Pusha T was like, oh, that shirt dope.
On the clips.
Yeah, right. So that's dope shirt. He posted it.
Right.
So that's, so him, everybody, you know, we're kind of like viral and people talking about it. Right. But I've been at the page. I've been promoting my positivity. I'm coming from before Fuck You Prison, all that. I promote positivity every time I talk to somebody. But, so now what I'm doing today to update you what I'm doing, I'm doing like a museum. I mean, like I done a fashion show. She came to my fashion show. It was a great turnout. Yeah. My first fashion show, and I made one to be like more of an educational fashion show. I let everybody else with their brand, but I wanted to end it with my educational fashion show. I mean, I brought the signs I did to say, you know, save the kids, don't kill kids, stop the violence. But the models wearing the signs. I want to do something different, and it turned out very successful. But what I'm trying to show people before I go to my next subject, that even guys incarcerated or people, you know, in the streets. You can do whatever you want to do when you want to do it. Just get up and do it. Trap house.
Right. Trap
pink,
house.
Pink. Right. T.I. got one, two chain. So I said, what I'm going to do, I'm going to do my own fucking museum. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to, just casting this Sunday, I'm going to do like four different rooms inside the I'm going to build four different rooms in there, inside my man's studio. One room going to be phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four. There's four phases to the game. The phase when you get one of the game, you first get in the game is when the money's fresh. And you get into it, you're still green behind the ears. You don't even know the disrespect that's going on. You don't even know where your life is heading at this time of the game. Feel me? So now phase two, it's more to phase one, I'm gonna break down. But phase two is when you get in the game, this is when the arrogance come, the money come, you went from nobody to somebody within a split second. So now you're gonna have a dead body on the ground, people walking over the body. Like, people don't care about you in this game. This game is a serious game. And on time, when you believe that the streets love you, or the game love you,
come on.
I mean, I'm gonna show you the game doesn't love you. I mean, like, I grew up in this game, you can't tell me nothing about this game. Phase three, we go to the mental stage, called the mental stage, you go to prison. Prison, that's where you're gonna see everything change for you. Everything you thought of one and two was illusion. This is reality.
Right.
You by yourself, everything's gonna break you down. It's gonna give you who you really wanna be, who you should be. Right. And phase four, the door, you walk out to freedom. And I'm gonna break all that down in my museum.
Right.
Feel me? So the casting I'm looking for, I'm gonna do like 60 people, right? Probably more. I'm gonna put them inside my museum. I'm gonna do different shows. But I'm gonna question everyone that come in there about their life. But I want everybody from the hood, and I can go get Fat Boy, I can go get rappers, I can get everywhere I want. I don't want them. I want people from the hood.
Right.
So now all these kids, they bring their baby mother, their kids in there, they went in there, and I'm gonna question them. But the people I'm really helping are the ones in the fashion show. I mean, the ones inside the museum.
Right.
Because they're going to be inside the show.
Right.
These are the ones I'm helping, not the ones in the audience.
Right. Gotcha.
You feel what I mean? So I can do
like
a room.
Therapeutic thing.
It's a reverse psychology. I can do a whole goddamn room and talk to a bunch of kids, but I'm going to put them in the museum.
Right.
And they're going to get some shine, get some fun, and people can take pictures with them, with the environment. So, you know, like when phase two, I'm going to play the music, everybody, you know, make it clap to this.
Right.
Then I'm going to go into, you know, the life of a hustler.
Right.
I'm gonna break down every page, every other hustle. I've written it down. I'm gonna break it down what a hustle go through.
Right.
Feel me? And what's the end result? Prison.
Gotcha. Mm-hmm.
By yourself. Mm-hmm. Feel me? So I'm gonna fingerprint everybody that walks in the door museum. They get to take pictures, everything. So I'm doing the casting Sunday to bring all the people in there to understand what the game is about. I'm just taking what I know. Right. I've never done this before. Right. Get this clip right here.
Right.
Well,
guess what?
Amazing for it.
I can't fail, right? Because I never done it before.
Let me say this.
You know, I'm gonna fail. So I'm looking for models. Everybody comes. Cameramen, vloggers.
We in the street and we live in a lifestyle. Listen, we gamble our life all the time. We gamble with our life. Every day you step out the house, you gambling with your life. Oh, we got a caller. Hello, caller. How you doing? H-Squad Rebel Radio, brother. You on live?
Yeah,
Pete King. Tell us your name, where you calling from.
Can I wallow?
Jay Ali, what's good, y'all? It's Jay Ali, what's
up? Jay, what's good, Jay? What's good?
What's up?
What's good, y'all? No, we didn't move
here. It's been on live, not on the phone.
It was acting crazy.
From the time I say
that. The live won't let me in, yo.
Hit my live.
Yeah, right?
We can hear you.
Look. And Chief, it's no replace tomorrow. You already said you're coming down here tomorrow.
All right.
All right, cool. So go ahead.
All right, yeah, no, and
that's what the museum's about.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do a play.
That's a good
concept. I already wrote my play for it too, so I'm really just trying to get, you know, bring a little more excitement. I don't keep talking about, yo, let's go to Atlanta, let's go to
New Jersey.
Do it right here. I'm gonna bring that love. I'm here. I'm gonna take the youth. I don't want no world actors. I don't want no real like, dude. I've been acting in 7 movies. Nah, homie. I want somebody up the hood, up that block.
Right.
I might have a neighborhood dude that get high.
Right.
In there. Feel me?
Yeah.
Right. I might be my man Luther Wright and then dudes I went to school with. Right. Shooting the game.
Yeah, word.
I don't grow up with him, so I'm looking for him. Right. Luther.
He's downtown north.
I'm going to go get his ass.
He's downtown north.
Right.
Yeah.
And
I grew up with him. DJ here.
So a little CD.
I grew up with him,
so I'm going to get my man Luther Wright.
Yeah.
He'll be in the museum. We're going to show y'all. Feel me? This is what the museum is about, to show y'all the game. Feel me? Because I can tell you about the game all day.
Right.
Feel me? I can talk about it all day. You ain't trying to. I want people to be involved. And see what's going on.
So what the spectators look like? Who coming through? Who you want to come through and step over these bodies? Who we bringing in there?
No, I don't know.
Right. I want teenagers.
I want, you know, people from up the block.
Yeah.
I don't want kids. I don't want no. I can get any rapper I want. Feel me? But I'm just going to give a show for 2 days, and then probably going to get me after that. Probably just buy me a fuck prison museum house and let people just come in there and see what's going on.
Okay.
I mean, I want straight off the block. I'm going to question these kids when they get, whoever come to casting, I got some questions for your ass. Okay. But I mean, and then we're going to have some fun.
Right.
But I'm not trying to, like I said before, even my play. I'm not trying to go get, I can do crazy shit.
Yeah, Chief. Chief talking. What happened, bro?
Yo, what's up, Chief?
Nah, I hear you. I said, what's poppin', boy?
You got the mic.
Can
you hear
him?
Yeah, we
got
hear
you.
You didn't know the topic.
I'm just listening to what
you're talking about. Yeah,
oh, yeah. No, Shawn, the question I want to ask you. On your re-entry, after doing the time, 20 years, and coming home, and you transitioning into the promoting and so on and so forth.
I'm going to tell you something.
Yeah. Do you, how did you feel that you was received by society, by people? Do you think you was embraced, or do you find it difficult for you to navigate?
I'm going to see. Well, I kind of like, you know, I came home a little different. Feel me? Like, I came home, and I'm saying, like, 100 grand strong, literally. 100,000. Now I came home different.
Right.
Feel me? Like, I was in jail. Like, everybody in Fort Dix is the only thing right here. I was shaking and bigger than that, man. Right. Feel me? Like, I threw 100 cell phones over the fence.
Right.
Feel me? I sold the cell phones at $1,500 cell phone. Feel me?
Now, see how he was still criminal that whole time?
Yeah, he was rocking. And
I was rocking. Like anyone in Fort Dix was like, that's how I saw the dude told me to do a party. What happens is, I was incarcerated, I was messing with a CO. So I told, I worked in the kitchen, I saw I wanted all the food, I stole a man food at the kitchen. I brought it to you, I fed the whole unit for free.
Right.
And like everybody can eat, 300 some inmates. And the dude was like, you need to go and do party, people just love you, Shawn, man. Like, you don't give a damn, my nigga.
Right.
And it's like, then from then I saw something, from then I was hustling in there. I mean, so I came home, I had a good family.
Right.
I had a good support system.
Right.
I'm coming home with money in my account, and then I got family on the streets. So it gave me a little head start.
Gotcha.
I mean, so that's why I just told them, yo, and it was, I already had a MySpace page in there. I already had a cell phone. So I was already promoting myself before I got here.
Right.
And for me, then I wrote Foxy Brown a letter while I was in jail. And then, I got my man Don Quan from Brooklyn, and she started, she came and picked me up from jail. So that made, like, you know, that was all over the Facebook.
Right.
But this time, all I knew about was MySpace, then with the Facebook. And then I was growing as time going on.
Right.
So when I came to be a promoter, I already had a strong base, a strong thing. And the crazy part about the story, like, all the people that used to write me in jail that were cool with me, after a while started being cool with me. Because everybody thought I was going to come and sell drugs.
Right.
So when I came home and tell them that I'm going to do parties, they're like, all right, nigga, we're going to keep going, nigga.
You're right in the flow.
You feel me? So,
we're homeless for you.
You know what I'm saying? Then I learned at that time that people hustle with me illegally, but they wouldn't hustle me legally.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And I became like, you know what I'm saying? So a lot of people took me as a joke, but I took myself as serious.
Right.
You feel me? Because I know, like, if I go back to prison, my end result. Feel me? Like, I know me. You know what I mean? And OG told me, he said, yo, see Supreme? Like, I know the Supremes. Well, I know Supreme, I know Wayne Davis,
I know everyone from Brooklyn. I knew Ken Do.
Right.
I knew Lou Hobbs. I knew these people personally.
Right.
For me, and they all got time, unbelievable numbers.
Right.
For me, I knew all the big dudes. I met them. Ronnie Bump from Queens. You know, Joe Hargrave. I met them all. Snake from Memphis, Pittsburgh. Why we talking about Rick Jones from Philly, JBM Mock. I know them all. I went 18. I grew up with all these OGs, and one thing this OG told me, he said, Shawn, the difference between you and the people you go home with, you have a CCE. 848. That's the highest charge you get in the federal building besides the murder.
Right.
If you go out there and forget who you are and get back into that drug trade, them dudes you with, you're going to get 5-10 years. You're going to get your name. Because my first one, 8-4 is a mandatory 20 years in prison. Mm. The second one is a mandatory 30. He broke it down to me. Listen to me, little nigga. Because I love you. Now, I know you like to play in the streets. If you go out there and play, them white people going to give you 30 years to life. You're going to get a life big. Next
right.
The dudes you with, because you smart. And the way you play, you're going to give it your all. They're going to get 5 or 10 years. You're getting a life big. You never know if you see the streets getting your life. So make sure your choices is wise because you're not like them.
Right.
You might look like them. They might dress like you. They might act like you, but you're not them. You have a very bad record with one bad charge, and that's going to ruin your life forever. For me, and I learned that. So sometimes I see dudes and I do some other day in the club, like, yo, you gotta, like, I admire you because I know you can get in drugs. I know you can get in the game and you won't do it. I said, nah, man, I knew them crack gonna do it to me, nigga.
Do you look at yourself as a role model?
No, I look at myself as just a regular person, like,
hey, G. G, you still on the line?
I'm here, baby.
You want to add on to some of this, man? We're talking about, you know, incarceration, the game, the criminal lifestyle, you know, the brothers out there in the hood, you know, all the killings, everything that's going on. What's your thoughts about some of that?
I mean, you know, my transition back into the free world was, like, it was probably similar to Sean's. I mean, I had a good family support, but at the same time, you know, I had the music, like, they could show me, well, you know, with the music, touching the body is kind of different. It ain't like
I even get a party.
Or you got a rape charge. You know what I'm saying? It's a whole
first came home.
So niggas kind of embraced it. You know what I mean? So since I've been home, there's been nothing. Yeah, there's been nothing but my love for the most part. As far as that, you know, it's just about getting acquainted with technology and all that. What have you? And just finding your niche, finding your lane to get money where you ain't really putting yourself in harm's way. You can make it without having to, you know, punch the clock and be working 9 to 5. Like, my thinking is just different. Like, I'm totally anti-government. I'm anti-police. I'm anti-everything with them. Like, just because, like, I'm even anti-taxes. Not because I feel like taxes pay for a lot of things, but at the same time, I feel like our tax money play the same police that's kicking our ass. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not really for that. So I just got a different mindset and in my mental, I just move a little different, you know what I mean? I got a different life philosophy.
I done this first party coming on.
Nice.
Have you found what your lane is right now? Or are you,
oh,
do
yeah,
you
I'm
still
see
it?
I'm in D.C., you know, and the cannabis thing is legal, so I'm running wild with this.
I feel you, bro.
Well, he didn't tell you when he first came when I told him.
What?
I met him, he came to a dinner party for him. My man Roger Bond was like, yo, Chielli, I did a party for him, and I told him, I said, slow down, get yourself together.
Right.
Pace yourself.
Right.
You know what I mean? You're going to do good for yourself. Right, Chielli?
That's a fact. I'm doing everything. I'm like,
I told him.
I just find that, you know, with the industry, I'm kind of turned off from the industry. The industry is too much friction for me, and I'm not like, me and Mike talk about it, and Mike's like, but gee, that's how this shit is, and I'm like, but that ain't what I'm about.
Yeah, if it ain't your energy.
Yeah, you know, like, I'm not really with that. Like, Sean can tell you, and Sean, we done did shit together, and it ain't never been no contract. Like, he say something, I say something, that's what it is. If it's an issue, we'll call, speak, text it out. It ain't never no me texting him 3 days, waiting for an answer, waiting for a reply, and see if I can do it or I can't do it. Simple men shit. And I'm just used to dealing with men. I guess from behind the wall, you know, it's a lot more respect. I'm just dealing with simple principles. If you, like, people be like, yo, that's my word. Nigga, once you speak, that's your word.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Oh, that's my word. That's my word, boss. Once you say it, that's your word. That's supposed to be your boss. So that's what it is. And unless it's, you
know, something very serious, then your word should not be broken. You know what I'm saying? That's what I live by. I live by, you know, if I pay you for a service, I want that service and I'm going to be happy. If I'm short on that service, I want some change. You know what I'm saying? Like regular simple shit. But it's like regular simple shit. It's shit that motherfuckers in this industry don't really live by. And they make it like, so they make the fake shit to know.
They make it make sense like you're a nut.
Yeah. I got a question for you, Ching. Quick question. So I know he said, hold on.
No, you're talking to somebody
else. I'm good now. We're talking to somebody else.
So one of the things that we're talking about during this campaign is the importance of a second chance. Would you say, I mean, someone of your stature, did you run into any roadblocks or had a hard time doing anything through your transition after you came home because of your incarceration?
Like right now, I just published my book, my autobiography, Another Kind of Freedom. Y'all can check it out at shawndx.com. But even with that, you know, it's people that are commenting, oh, he killed the nigga, this, that, the third. I killed somebody. I was a young motherfucker in these New York City streets. I killed somebody. The judge sentenced me to 14 years. The victim's family was okay with the DA, the judge sentenced me to 14 years. I did my time. I'm off parole. So now what you want me to do? You want me to go kill myself? I got to move on.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And it's like people, some people be like, oh, fuck that. So I'm not supposed to move on. What you want me to do? I did bad. I did what the judge told me to do. All the shit I do, whether I'm with Jamila in the schools or with Erica Langford in the jail, that's me giving back from me. Ain't no judge mandate to me to none of that. That's me giving back because I want to. That's me trying to help a nigga maybe not go through what I did, or maybe help a motherfucker not say the things that maybe trigger a person to shoot him. You know what I'm saying? So that's me giving back. But I can't turn back the hands of time.
That's
I'm sorry for what happened, but I got to do more.
Hey Chi, I got a question for you too.
I'm listening.
Yeah. Now, in light of you being an artist, you know, at that point, you was young, you was in the game, you was an artist, you know, and stuff like that, and you catching the charge. Now, I'm talking about in terms of life imitating art or art imitating life. Like, what advice would you have for any young artists out here if they portraying that lifestyle? You know, like, for example, with the Tekashi 6ix9ine situation, or Bobby Shmurda, dudes like that was still in the streets and still portraying that lifestyle over all their records and stuff like that, getting caught up, getting incarcerated, catching cases, or having people in your entourage that's living that off-the-hook lifestyle that get you put in these situations. Like, what would you say to any young artists or up-and-coming artists that want to portray that gangster lifestyle through their music?
I mean, my shit is this. Everybody ain't broke. You know what I mean? Some people grow up and is living it, and that's the story they're going to tell. So, you know what I mean? I can't tell him not to tell his story. It's accurate. But I will say for the brothers that ain't living it, it's like, why glorify negativity that you ain't even living, you ain't experienced? You know what I'm saying? And then when she gets funky, you know you're not ready for it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, Bobby Shmurda, he held shit down for his man. I commend him. And at the same time, people understand, when you hear a lot of these rappers talking and all that, yo, a lot of times there's money behind them that you don't know about. And a lot of that money is street money. You know what I'm saying? So a lot of motherfuckers is living it, bro. Like, everybody ain't fronting and everybody ain't no rat. But some niggas ain't about it, man. You know what I mean? And I can't distinguish who's who and who's gonna tell and who's not. I would just say, man, everybody, before you make decisions, weigh out the pros and cons. Don't just think, if you're wrong, the bank, sure, it's dope if we get away with the $2 million. But if we don't get away, an 80% chance we not, then what?
Yeah,
we're ready for that. Weigh out the pros and cons, and if you can deal with the cons, and that's what you want to do, then by all means, do you. But, you know, if you can't, stay the fuck away, bro. Like, it's nothing wrong with being legal. It's nothing wrong with not committing crime. Like, I don't know why that shit got such a bad rap. Like, nobody want to be there no more, and it's cool to be you. You know what I'm saying? I'd rather a motherfucker tell me, gee, I don't want to do that, rather than the nigga say, yeah, let's do it and tell on me.
Right.
Gotcha.
Yeah, that makes sense, brother. Well, you know, I just want to say, man, you know, I mean, it's I commend you, you know, for being able to make that transition, coming from what you've been through, you know, and being able to reinvent yourself. Cause that, you know, let me tell you something, you know, it ain't no crime, you know, and failing and making errors and making mistakes in life. But the true crime is not learning the lessons from no mistakes.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And to be able to reinvent yourself, you know, ain't always an easy thing, you know, and to get back to it, you know, it's hard, right? And to start anew again and build a new brand for yourself, you know what I'm saying? So any brothers that made that transition, you know, I'm one of them brothers myself, you know what I'm saying? So I understand, you know, I went from being in the system to working in the system now, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, that's something that I never thought in a million years I would be in that position at this point in my life. But anything is attainable if you put your mind to it, you know, and you stay focused.
That bumps me out too when I go back into the jail. Like that shit, the smell, yo, that shit is like, damn, B, I remember this smell. That shit creeps me out, bro.
Right. Hey, listen, man, I ride past prisons and shit now, and I'll be squirming when I ride past them, just looking at them.
I actually go right into Rikers Island twice a week.
Right.
I go into the same houses that I used to work in. So.
Right.
I'm at OBCC. That's a jail that's known. It's oldest bantam correction facility.
I hated old boy.
But it's old boy, right? Only.
I hated that building.
Yeah, so that jail on right is known as only Bloods can't control.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's been predominantly banned by Bloods for since the 90s. And I go into that. I just run that those same houses, being there, running the seals, everything. Now I walk into those houses and I work, I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is the inspiration for them to see that give back, right?
Right.
This officer, there's depths I see, waters that know me. McPhatter, man, keep them to good work. Like, you know, they know I was that problem. I was shutting down jails and writers, right?
Absolutely.
So now, to be that example, to get back in front of them, right? When I have an ID that allows me to walk into these facilities.
Right.
This correction officer see me, they mad. Right, they're trying to stop me from doing the work that I'm doing there today. He's still a gamer. I'm hearing, you know, these are conversations. I never said I wasn't when I first came into this work. Right, it's not what you are; it's what you're doing.
Right. Right.
Nothing around me I'm doing is criminal. Right,
right.
I don't talk to nobody about nothing criminal. Right, everything about me is progression and solution. And now I'm getting in there and showing them that. So now they had individuals that were very violent that you had to do 30 days without tickets to get out of the enhanced unit. They wasn't leveling up. It's called leveling up. When we started working with them, Muslim leveling up now. They're like, wow, what is it that y'all doing? I said, we being real with them about the realities, about the choices they making. Prison, especially Rikers, you become a product of that once you go in there, right? Either you're gonna adjust yourself or it's gonna adjust you. So now people go in there and they fall as victim, right? For example, we talking about Rikers Island segregated. They separate in gangs by sex. They separate in Bloods by sex. That's not in state prison. So you prepping them, and you continuing to add to the violence by separating them.
Absolutely.
Right? Because you become alien to me because I don't understand the issues of what you're going through because somebody done told you, as a Blood, as a Bren, that you got a problem with a stone. Right? Mm-hmm. These are issues that we're overcoming now. So it changes. And they support these negatives. When they see a shift in our positive, they'll redirect where they focus that negative at. Right?
Mm-hmm.
So, they woke up over here. So we've been planning for years, so we're going to shift it this way, right? We're going to throw it, right? And that's what we tell them. They said, so you don't think this works? I said, how are you working if these guys are now about to go to state prison and you separating them right here? What do you think will happen when they get up to state prison?
Right.
They're accustomed to it. They don't know how to relate to each other. So you add into the violence, right?
Right.
You got COs that'll shift you and push you in the house because they know that your op is over there, right? They're added to the violence, right? So we have to really be inside these facilities ourselves and hold them accountable because the system is not going to hold each other accountable. The correction officer, just like NYPD, the captain and the deputy is going to protect down the line, right? So we have to make sure that we, like I said earlier, who have the ability to go back into these facilities and bring our expertise, bring our experience and our new education,
right?
Well, so you got to understand, it's job security. You know, I mean, for people that work in these facilities, and I happen to be one, you know, but at the end of the day, guys, you know, the continuation of people being incarcerated is job security for people that work in these facilities, in these prisons, and so on and so forth. It's a multi-billion dollar industry. You know, it's not about rehabilitation no more. You know, it's just about punishment and, you know, getting paid. It's
prison,
about money.
Prison for profits now. Remember that.
Oh, prison for profits. Absolutely. Private industry. That's how I'm able to work in the system because I work in the private industry.
And New York City, in order to hold one inmate on Rikers Island for a year, the total taxpayer cost is $270,000.
That's per inmate.
Everything that surrounds going to court and feeding and housing and transportation and all those factors, $270,000 a year per inmate. how much does it cost to put that young person or older person in college, right? Right, and that's not what they want, remember. So once we got to get you through the, we got to get you through the detained facility to get you to the mass incarceration facility so that we can continue to push the industrial businesses, like the eyeglasses, license plate, the clothing, the tables. You'd be surprised
what cool craft makes.
Right.
Everything they push.
Everything
is pushed. That's why I talk about the school to prison pipeline. It's a real thing. It really exists and it's really going on. You know, that's why I said, you know, to get these kids staying on the right track, it has to be a collective effort in the communities. And, you know, even the public school system is a part of that school to prison pipeline. They the way that they miseducate our children, all right, leads to that mentality that puts them out there in the streets and leads to them being kicked out of school or dropping
out
of school.
It's not just the miseducation. It's the shift in schools, right? So once you become, they have a system where once you get in trouble as a young person, they put that on your record.
Right.
Once that makes your school record, they start to shift you through certain schools, school districts,
special ed,
to eventually land you into one of those troubled schools with the hopes of you falling victim to that, right? It's all set like that. So what I try to do when we talk about high-risk individual, I like to identify high-risk, high-risk to shoot or be shot. How do I help you? I don't care about nobody else. I need to pull you away from your homies and everybody else. And how do I focus on you, right? And what is it that you need? Because that goes back to the second chance and what do we have, right, after incarceration. How can I provide you with what you need, single, separately, and for your family, right? And we grouping so many of our people into that pot of everybody got the same issues. That's not factual, right? So looking at that, I'm somebody who comes from being an example of being looked at from my history and what I represent, right? And we want people to be comfortable with what you can bring to the table. I think that's what the problem is. Not being afraid to be innovative, right? Mm-hmm. That's it, right? Gangsters making that strong community changes. Who the fuck gonna go to prison? This is innovative. This is shit people look at and they shun on. They want to talk about us like we wild and we don't know what we're talking about because they don't understand our introduction into our community to deal with the healing and the trauma.
And who you talking to? Right,
they're not gonna relate.
Right.
I did a school in Jersey one time and I came into the high-risk individual in Patterson.
Right.
This is early now before when I first came home. So I came in with the suit and they like, yo, fuck, I can't even talk about
it. Yeah.
But I was prepping them for that. They didn't know that. Right, and I told Jesus, watch this. I had my bag already, so I said, "Yo, these homies wild." So you know, let me go change my clothes. Went to the bathroom for 10 minutes, came back, and threw my rap sheet in front of him. Like, now what y'all talking about? The whole energy change.
Right.
Rap sheet, clothing change. Or we thought, you thought something was what I had on, right? But they not accustomed to that, so you have to meet them where they are, right? We do that, then we shift them. Like, and I always we start to put them now at least 2 days a week. We got. My guy does 100 suits, Kevin Livingston. You get suits. Right. We're going to put you in a suit at least one day a week just to go to school. You ain't got to know just to go to school in that professional attire. And see, they came back like, I felt different. I was treated different today by not only the teachers, but my peers, right? So we had to start showing them and giving them the tools to be different and shift their lives.
I appreciate you saying we so much. And that's the thing that I wanted us to kind of like touch base to on. Like, I think oftentimes we... What you say, Che?
No,
you're fine. Go ahead. So oftentimes, you know, I think we put so much, we expect expectations on the school and the criminal system and, you know, everybody but ourselves, you know, in our homes, just the community as a whole. You have a lot of organizations that get together. You know, it doesn't have to be crab in a barrel. We all work together. You know, one organization bring one thing to the table, another organization bring another, and we work together because at the end of the day, it's our community. You know what I mean? It's our community.
What's the problem we all know it takes?
I feel like until we get our home and come to the table with our own and feet on the yard, I don't feel we ever justice. I don't feel we can get our justice by begging and coming with our hand out. We're still learning their education for the most part. You know what I'm saying? Like, we need to segregate. I mean, I love Martin Luther King and he did so much. However, when they ended segregation, it's like we fell into their hands. We let go of our independence. Like, yo, before segregation, we had to have our own bathroom, our own restaurant, our own cleaners, our own water fountain. So we had to teach our own kids. different things, but now it's like we're forced to live and learn their education through this segregation shit, and we keep getting a foot in our ass. Mm-hmm. And we wondering why, because man, they in power, they built this shit to keep us down.
Integration.
We
need
education to take their foot out on our country and it's like, nigga, this is why we come to keep our food on y'all neck. You know what I'm saying? So it's like we
talk about
this, but
that's not what this
is for. So until we get out of that mind state that they gonna give us equality, I think we're gonna be in a fucked up state, bro.
They're
never gonna get out of this, bro. We gotta take ours. We gotta go get ours. We gotta take ours. Our land, our own property, and fuck them. Once we get situated and we build up our own economy, then we can come to integrate.
But it start on a smaller scale. Let me copy off of you, Chief.
It will kill half of us.
But it don't have to be so. It don't have to be so deep.
At the end of the day, with no bullshit, that's really where it stands at. You can't ask the rapist not to rape you. That doesn't work. You gotta fight your way out the box. So anybody that thinks this, that we're not up for a fight for what we want, you out the wrong. When we were talking in the beginning, it ain't even we don't like each other, we don't like ourselves. That personal hate that you deal with to most people is dealing with the fact that most people don't like themselves. You ain't respecting yourself. There's a hate with yourself. You ain't getting it, but you looking in the mirror when you hating yourself. You need certain things to make you feel a certain way. You don't just get up with the proper energy.
When you disrespect another, I disrespect you or kill you, I'm killing myself. No difference.
It all starts with being able to learn that, and to learn that, when you disrespect someone,
it's like an old saying. You never disrespect no one mother because that's like you disrespecting them.
That's
the same saying. If you disrespect a person, it's the same saying. Right. We would disrespect, like right now, back in the day, you never disrespect my mother.
Right.
Because it'd be like disrespect your mother.
Right.
But they basically were saying, tell you that back then.
Right.
That if you shoot me, it's like shooting yourself.
Right.
We're on the same team.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I tell hustlers all the time, like, yo, I got too much against me.
Right.
To be beefing with you.
Right.
I got the feds on my heels. I got the DA on my heels. I got the IRS on my heels. I got whoever else, goddamn HC, right. B letters on my heels.
Yeah.
I can't beef with you, homie.
Right.
My problem is not you. My problem is not you.
Right.
If I'm trying to live, homie, I've been on this show, baby, I've been here 30 minutes. I just got old 30 minutes.
Right.
Just that quick. I just aged 30 minutes.
Right.
So I'm trying to live and do things for other people and my family. My beef is never could be you.
Right.
My beef can't be you. Feel me? And when every second I live on, every second that I'm here talking, I'm getting older at the time. Time is against me.
Absolutely.
And so everything I do has to count into for bigger things. So me beefing with you, me arguing with you, me arguing with whoever, it doesn't make any sense to me anymore. And it took me, it was going to take you years to learn this right here. That every day you're aging, every day you're getting older, it's going to take years to learn that. We don't understand that.
Right.
So me killing or disrespecting, for me, like, I salute. For me, end of the day, I want to see the next man go come up. I want to see the next man grow. I want to see the next man go to the next level. But don't get it twisted. We are aging every second, every minute, and we're killing each other.
Right.
For me, like the other day, we're killing each other in rapid numbers, in character, spirit. For me, we're killing each other. And I'm saying name anything like anything is to break someone else down, and you doing this is within your minutes, your seconds. For me. You're working backwards.
Right.
You got too much you gotta do.
Right.
Damn me.
Right.
Like you got a lot you gotta do. You got a lot you gotta do. Him, the brother right here, they gotta do as for your family,
right.
Your structure.
Right.
Feel me? And when every time we beef with each other, every time we set yourself back. So when you wake up in the morning and you argue with a person for 30 minutes. You just got old for 30 minutes.
Right.
You're not looking like that. You just aged it 30 minutes of your life. You just, so people understand that.
Some nonsense.
Feel me? So when you do something beefing, we looking for him, I'm aging as I'm beefing with you.
Right.
When I'm supposed to be elevating, you know what I'm saying, to another level to do things positive that I got to leave behind for my grandkids and his grandkids. Like we cheating ourselves out of so much, and these people know that.
these people deal with a high elevation, mental. They know that. When they write these books and they manipulate on your mind, you go into courthouses, they know what they're playing with. I took 20 years of my life.
Right.
I aged it in that motherfucker from 18 to 39.
Right.
For me, I spent 2 years of my son on the streets. My life, my son, I'll be going on 48 years old. I might have sent my son 2 years on the streets my entire life.
Right.
I blew that time.
Right.
Beefing in the streets, trying to get money, chasing that gangster lifestyle. Feel me? Now here I'm damn near 40 years old. I don't supposed to be here.
Right.
I'm supposed to be on the goddamn island somewhere, retired, chilling.
Right.
But now I'm chasing the last years of my life, every second, to do the right thing. Like, yo, why is he acting like that? Yo, I'm aging every day. Fuck that. I'm aging every second.
Right.
If I'm not doing nothing positive, then I'm at war with myself.
Right.
So I'm at war with myself. I'm at war with the world.
Right.
Feel me? And I'm at war with anyone that's against what I'm trying to do.
But, you know, and the system is designed, you know, to take a lot of your productive years away from you when you were animal, when you were beast, when
savage.
You were young, savage. They strip them years, and by the time, if you ain't paying attention, you playing attention, by the time you get out of there, you broke down, man.
You saw that tiger?
You
saw that tiger? Yeah, exactly. That tiger at that jungle?
That's what I'm telling you. That's
they put him in that cage?
Right.
Exactly. Then you see him, he don't roar no more.
Beat down, yeah, he don't even roar.
They don't
no
broke his spirit, my nigga.
Right, and break your spirit.
They don't broke his fucking spirit, my nigga.
Young lion years, and then, you know, you be a beat up old man, sickly, all kind of ailments, you know, walking with a cane.
I know one of my friends, man. He did all that time in prison, I'm saying, he came home and died, my nigga.
Yeah.
The fuck out of here.
Crazy.
Crazy. That's why I said, people like, why you eat vegan? Why you going vegan? Why you doing this? I'm trying to live. I don't have a choice.
Right.
The game is against me. The game is for me. But like I said before, I love coming to the show, love talking to brothers.
And listen, because I just said to the brother, I didn't even realize that was Jamila Davis standing right there.
Yeah, Jamila Davis.
Yeah, I looked that up when I came in. I didn't realize. So I'm sitting, I just said over to the brother, I said, is that Jamila? He was like, yeah.
Miss Davis.
You know, I mean, her story, I mean, I follow her on Instagram. And how I came to know about her story, was watching her Instagram. I just out of the blue, I seen her Instagram one day and I started following her story and the inspiration of a lot of the females that, you know, she went through, you know, with in that situation. And it was inspiring. You know what I'm saying? And I befriended her and I've been watching her story. Her story is a very inspirational one as well. You know what I'm saying? So I'll be remiss not to, you know, mention her name because she is in the building. You know what I'm saying? So we appreciate, you know, everybody that's been through the struggle and everybody that's continuing to fight the good fight. You know, the brother right here, we're going to take a moment before we wrap up. You know, give your name again. If you have any contact information with people to reach you, your email, phone number, whatever, your name of your organization, and how people can get in touch with you.
It's my camera, man.
Yeah, definitely. My camera, man. You know, you can catch me on Instagram, Trifling, Gangster. Online, Facebook, my organization, Gangster Making Economic Community Changes. You can catch us at www.gangstermackin.com. That's G-A-N-G-S-T-A, gangster. It's the difference between a gangster and a gangster. It's a fact.
Facts.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, look up, Google me online. My name is Shanduke McPhatter. Look at the work of G-MACC Incorporated and see what we're doing in our city. We're changing lives. We're changing mindset. That's how we're changing lives. And we're changing the way shooters are responding to violence in their communities. We have to do our job. So, as they say, it takes a village to raise the children, I say the village makes the villain. So stop making villains in our community.
Hey, Chief, let you go real quick. Hey, TLE.
Yo.
Yeah, you want to give them your information, let them know what you're doing out there?
Hey, everybody, go grab that book, Another Kind of Freedom. Other than that,
it's just TLEBX,
everything.
And the documentary. Wait, we want to know about the documentary real quick.
I'm saying the documentary, just listen up. You got to go to my Instagram, TLEBX.com, and we're going to be having a New York premiere in early June. So just look for the date and the venue.
All right, early June. Everybody be on the lookout for that. The TLE documentary in early June.
Yeah, early June. But you can go get that book right now, Another Kind of Freedom, TLEBX.com.
Yeah.
Right. Shout out to the brother Chi Ali, man, out there on the check-in, on the call-in. We appreciate you calling in and sharing your experience with us. You know, and we, like I said, we commend you for your transition, brother, back into free society and the wonderful things that you're doing out there in the community, man. You know, keep doing what you're doing. Stay focused, brother, you know, and hold the line.
For sure. Hey,
I'm trying to
put y'all fucking with tonight.
I hit you when I get up out of here. You still supposed to be in with my five books, FYI.
Yeah, I saw the post.
Yeah, you saw that, right? Yeah, you supposed to be in my bazaar. I get it. I hit you when we get out of here.
Alright, I'm on my way to the city. I'll be out there like 2-3 hours.
Alright, bro.
Alright, peace.
Hey, Shawn.
Peace.
Let him know what you're doing, bro.
Oh, man, Shawn Hartwell. I'm doing a Fourth Prison Museum casting this Sunday. I would like for everyone to come out. Have some fun. We're going to talk about the museum, what it's going to do for the youth, bring awareness, we're saying, bring understanding to the game, and why you should want to go to prison, and why you try to keep yourself out of prison. And if you've never been in prison, you know what I'm saying, for the youth, it's just something to learn. So you understand what you get yourself into, because sometimes we don't know what we get ourselves into. Because I knew goddamn well. I ain't always been facing 20 years of selling no drugs on a corner in no party homes. So sometimes we don't know where the game going to take us at. But one thing for sure, if a person that been through the game, he going to tell you where it can take you at.
Right.
To give you awareness. I mean, then you with the choice, you make the choice if you still want to go ahead and take it to the next level, which you can handle. But we always need to know what can we handle and what we can't handle. So, you know, fuck the president. Who the fuck will the president pays follow it? Maybe it's a positive movement. And I'm saying he has a little harsh words to it, but in reality, being in jail is going to be harsh too.
Absolutely.
Peace.
Hey, how did we get a hold? Because I DM'd you for one of them fuck prison sweatshirts, and you ain't holler back. How we get a hold of them shirts and that apparel?
Oh, wait, that's online. That's on Google. Okay. Fuck prison online.
Okay.
I mean, but I was in a rush coming here.
Right.
Because I was running this morning trying to do a lot of things, and she called me and gave her a reminder because my brain is everywhere.
And
right. Brain, you. For me, and my brain is everywhere when you're trying to do so much.
Right. Yeah.
And, you know, because people are pulling you. Right. Everybody wants something from you when you're trying to do the right thing.
Right.
Because you might see some, you might do it from the heart and positivity.
Right.
But this person sees money.
Right.
Like, he can make me some money. So everybody's pulling me everywhere, so I gotta slow down some time. Like, yo, what are you talking about?
What's the most?
What are you just saying again?
Right.
Feel me? So when you know, that goes to a lot, because people see me, they see me as money, as an asset.
Right.
Feel me? So everybody around me, I gotta watch them.
Absolutely.
Feel me? Because sometimes people's agendas is not your agenda.
Absolutely.
Feel me? They just want for the ride.
Absolutely.
But the truth. Always come out. The truth always.
Everyone should give a shout out to Shawn because he came to our facility to our alumni meeting last month at Tower Hall.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, he came.
I'm going to do something for Tower Hall. I'm going to give all the brothers some sweatshirts in there that don't have stuff.
Okay.
That's what I want to
do. Take donations and stuff.
I want to do donations to the brothers that's struggling. I know how it is. Well, I know how it is to be in the halfway house. The other brothers won't have anything.
Right.
Feel me? It's rough sometimes. You just get them back on your good foot.
Right.
Like James Brown said.
That's right.
Stand
there. Try.
Clap on that.
Well, that being said, yo, we thank you.
I need your number. I'm trying to get some
money. Okay. Yes. Try and wrap it up for us.
Definitely.
Before we close all the way out, I'm sorry, Bustin, because I'm real, real excited about the stuff Trifex is doing out in Brooklyn. It trickles over here, right? Because we constantly going back and forth. So let people know how they can find, you know, your organization. I have a little brother actually that's locked up in New York right now. He's going to be transitioned. I would definitely love for him to come through
gangsters. Oh, real quick, let me say before you start. When I was in the game, they wasn't locking us up in New York. You got caught in New York with drugs. They pour it out and tell you go back over the bridge.
Get your ass back to Jersey.
Yeah, yeah. Giuliani changed all that.
Yeah, they had my brother hostage over that month.
We actually, Thursday, can I mention that? I don't know. Thursday? I mentioned it anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got a meeting with the mayor Thursday. For Jersey. Yeah.
Ooh, nice.
We are, one thing we working on is working together with Jersey.
Right.
Coming up in Brooklyn, I've never seen a difference other than the tunnel.
Right.
It's the same difference in how we respond, Newark and Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
So we want to really focus on that and bring services and change the mindsets in Jersey like we're doing in Brooklyn. We also need in June, that's Gun Violence Awareness Month, right? And we just really want to focus on a lot of things that's happening in our cities in June to bring awareness to gun violence in general. Also, I missed this plug, June 20th.
The Gangsta Ball.
The Gangsta Gala, you got to be. Sandcastle, Long Island.
I'll get your information anyway.
Yes, it is a wedding venue. They don't know how I got it, but I pulled it off 3 years in a row. This is the fourth annual Gangsta Gala, suited and booted. Go to Eventbrite, pull up Gangsta, G-A-N-G-S-T-A Gala. And you don't want to miss this event, man. It's going down. That's Jim Miller's word.
Alright, y'all, with that being said, we're going to hit our sponsors real quick. And we're going to get up out of here. We want to give a shout out to New York Gyro King, Burger King, International Popcorn, Teacher's Cornbread Cafe, and Sugar Hill Beer. With that being said,
don't be forgetting the vinyl, bro.
And don't forget the vinyl. Alright, and with that being said, we signing out. A Squad Rebel Radio.